Good afternoon, good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining me. This is the lovely podcast, The Endurance of Labor Laws. I am your lovely host, Leslie Sullivan. And today is episode 65. Today we're going to take a look at the Superfund sites in my home state of Oklahoma. But first of all, I want to give a big shout out to my listeners, so let me go to my lovely list here. So a big shout out to Virginia, Texas, New York, Oklahoma, Pennsylvania, Alabama, British Columbia, Oregon, Massachusetts, and Florida. Hey, Florida, how are you? And in terms of countries listed, a big shout-out to the United States, Canada, and the United Kingdom. This is wonderful. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started on this one. And this should be interesting because I'm learning a lot about Oklahoma. And some of these sites have already been taken off the list. They were completed and deleted, so that's good. There's like one or two, or there's one that's being proposed to be added to the national priorities list. So let's go ahead and get started on this one. I do want to make a note here that Oklahoma does not have as many as California or New Jersey. So that's really good for Oklahoma because we do a lot of oil and gas and refinery here. And I will say this, we are not very happy with the high prices at the gas pump. And I'm really disappointed that we are no longer doing that pipeline from Canada because that has greatly raised our rates in terms of the rates at the gas pump because now we're having to import oil and gas. So even though Oklahoma, normally we do a lot of business in terms of oil and gas, but because the Biden administration and or the EPA is pulling ranks on being able to have natural resources here at home, now we're paying almost $4 to $5 a gallon at the pump when we're just importing natural resources that we already have here at home. So from what I understand, we are getting our oil and gas either from the Middle East or from the pipeline that is between Germany and Russia. So there's a lot going on with that, and I think that's very unfortunate because that is affecting gas prices all across the United States, but especially here in Oklahoma, because whenever we have problems with EPA or the government trying to crack down on oil and gas companies, literally we lose hundreds, if not thousands, of jobs here, and companies end up closing shop. So that means people have lost their jobs, they've lost their pay, they've lost their health insurance. They've lost their life insurance. They have lost access to medical treatment, to medical care, because now they no longer have health insurance. And there will be those that say, oh, we'll just have socialized medicine. We don't want that crap, because it is crap. Socialized medicine is not the answer. Socialized medicine is where the government literally decides whether or not you get treatment or not, whether they value you as a human being or not. If we already have a government that's saying, oh, we don't care how much money you have to spend at the pump, why would they care about your life and the medicines that you have to take or that you need to take to stay alive or to fight off an infection or whatever the case may be? And, you know, this current administration, they're not the worst one. I think Obama was pretty bad, and then worse than Obama was President Carter. But I really think we need to get back to focusing on the United States, and we need to be self-sufficient and self-reliant. But unfortunately, we have people within the current administration, for some reason, they're not pro-United States. It's like they want to send all of our jobs overseas. They want us to have to pay all these taxes and then import stuff that we actually already have here at home. I personally don't understand that. Excuse me, but the United States, especially Oklahoma, whenever something goes on with oil and gas, we really feel it here. And Oklahoma is a wonderful state. I mean, we're not the prettiest state in terms of landscape and, you know, scenery, I guess you could say. But, you know, we have really good people that live here, and we're hardworking, and we do not appreciate the inflation that is taking place in our country right now. So, needless to say, please lift up some prayers for the United States and for our oil and gas companies, not just in Oklahoma, but in the entire United States. And we need that pipeline between Canada and the United States. We need that because that's how we remain self-reliant, and that's how we don't let other countries dominate us and don't rip us a new one, whether it's at the pump or at the bank. So we really need to be self-reliant, because then we are in control of our economy, not outside forces that don't really care about us anyway. But I digress on that. But I am impressed with Oklahoma that we only have eight or nine Superfund sites, considering how much we do, or usually do, in terms of oil and gas. And I'm just impressed with that, because a lot of people, they don't always think the best about the central part of the United States, and they kind of think that Oklahoma is just some stupid hick state. Do we have some stupid people? Yes. Do we have some hicks? Yes. But are we a stupid hick state? No. People move here all the time from other states because where they're coming from, which is usually California or New York, mostly California, they can't handle the high taxes, and they can't handle or afford the real estate tax and the tyrannical government that is out in California, just the craziness of stuff out there. Like, it's so environmental, it's nutty. Like, I am all in favor of being concerned about the environment, being a good steward of what we have been given, but there's normal and then there's crazy. And what sucks is when you have a kind of abnormal government in the way they think, and they just think that they should have these rules, laws, and regulations that go above and beyond the normal call of duty of your governing entity, and instead of it helping the citizen, instead of helping the citizens, excuse me, they're punishing them, basically for needing to drive a car or for needing to operate a business, or, you know, wanting to make sure that they have enough fuel in their car or that they can afford it. I mean, it's just unbelievable the things that we hear about from people that move here from California, or move to here from California, excuse me. And my mouth is a little dry. Hold on just a second, because we got another cold snap. It's like 28 degrees outside. Very much dry air for sure. But anyway, let's go ahead and get started on this list. But again, it's not as bad as California or New Jersey. So let's go ahead and take a look at this. The first one, the first Oklahoma Superfund site is Hartage Criner. This one is located in McLean County. And McLean County, let's see, as of the 2010 census, so this is a little outdated, it has 34,506 people living in that county, and that was back in 2010. So if you live in McLean County, just FYI, you do have a Superfund site. And it says here, the problem is groundwater and soil contaminated with metals, polychlorinated biphenyls, persistent organic pollutants, pesticides, volatile organic compounds. Let me see when this was added to the list. It was added to the list, that's going to be September 8th, 1983, so it is still very much there. And I'm just surprised that something from the 80s is still on this list. I just think that's crazy. But the next Oklahoma Superfund site is Hudson Refinery. This one is located in Payne County, Oklahoma. Let's see, as of 2010, so this is a little outdated, they have 77,350 people living in that area. So if you live in the county of Payne, literally Payne, just FYI, you have a Superfund site there. And so the problem with this one is soil, sediment, and surface water contamination by TEL, hydrogen sulfide, benzene, hydrochloric acid, hydrosulfuric acid, hydrogen fluoride, mercury, arsenic, chromium, ammonia, calcium, hypochlorite, and asbestos. This one was added to the list July 22, 1999. The next Oklahoma Superfund site is Imperial Refining Company. This one is located in the county of Carter. And as of 2010, so again, very outdated numbers here, their population is 47,557 people live in this county. So if you live in the county of Carter, Oklahoma, you do have a Superfund site there. Let's see, the problem with this one is waste piles, soil and contamination by benzene, ethyl benzene, toluene, I'm not sure I pronounced that, xylene, PAHs, oil and grease, and metals including arsenic from refining operations that ended in 1934. This one was added to the list July 27th, 2000, and it's still there. That's a problem because we're looking at 22 years since they have added it to the list, and it has not been cleaned up. The next Oklahoma Superfund site is Mosley Road Sanitary Landfill. This one is located in the county of Oklahoma. Let's see how many people live in this. Let's see. As of 2010, the population for Oklahoma County is 718,633 people. And again, that's outdated data, but if you live in the county of Oklahoma, you have a Superfund site there. Let's see what the issue is with this one. It says groundwater contamination by benzene and vinyl chloride from former disposal of around 2 million gallons of industrial waste into unlined pits. So the way they could have avoided that is to basically line the pit and do it properly. This one was added to the list. That's going to be February 21st, 1990. Let's see here. Da-da-da. This one is a suggested one that needs to be added to the list. So this one is National Zinc Corporation. This one is in the county of Washington. Let's see. As of 2020 census, the population of Washington County in Oklahoma is 52,455 people. So if you live in the county of Washington, you have a Superfund site. Let's see here. The problem with this one is lead, cadmium, and arsenic contamination of soil from former zinc smelting operations. Let's see here. I'm trying to think. They proposed that it be on the list in May 1993, but they still have not completely added it to the national priorities list, so they're kind of delayed on this puppy here. The next Superfund site, this one is Oklahoma Refining Company. This one is in the county of Cato. I'm not sure I pronounced that county because I never heard of it. Let's see how many people live in that county. As of 2010, again, very outdated numbers here. The population of Cato County is 29,600 people. So if you live in the county of Cato, you have a Superfund site. Let's see what the problem with this one is. It says debris, groundwater, surface water, soil and sediment contamination by base neutral acids, metals, PAHs, and VOCs. This one was added to the list. That's going to be February 21st, 1990. The next Oklahoma Superfund site is Tar Creek. This one is located in the county of Ottawa. Let's see how many people live there. As of 2020 census, the population for Ottawa County is 30,285 people. So if you live in the county of Ottawa, you do have a Superfund site in your area. Let's see what this one says about its problem. It says it has groundwater, surface water, soil, and fish tissue contaminated with cadmium, iron, lead, and zinc. So for sure, do not eat the fish out of that creek. Let's see here. This one was added to the list. That's going to be September 8th, 1983. And let me get a drink of water. I'll be right back. Okay, I'm back. So the next Oklahoma Superfund site is Tinker Air Force Base, but I think it's like a building because we still have Tinker Air Force Base, but there's a site near it or around it that is included in the base. So I'm guessing they've probably sectioned that part off because it's still an open base and people work there. So it's Tinker Air Force Base and is located in the county of Oklahoma. Let's see, it says its problem is groundwater contamination by chlorinated solvents and hexavalent chromium. It was added to the list July 22, 1987. The next Oklahoma Superfund site is Tulsa Fuel and Manufacturing. This one is located in the county of Tulsa. Tulsa County as of 2010, again, outdated numbers here, but as of 2010 census, they have 603,403 people living in that county. Let's see what the problem is with this one. It says soil contamination by heavy metals, including lead, cadmium, and arsenic from former zinc smelting operations. This one was added to the list January 19, 1999. The next Oklahoma Superfund site is Wilcox Oil Company. This one is located in the county of Creek. And I don't have a population number for this one, but let's see what the problem is. It says they have soil contamination by oil and oil refinement. Let's see, lead, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, also known as PAHs, contamination. This one was added to the list. That's going to be December 12th, 2013. So that is it for the Superfund sites in the state of Oklahoma, so kind of short and sweet. I will say this. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's see. Yeah, 5 of them that were previously deleted, so they were cleaned up. So that's good. But we still have about 8 or 9 more to take care of, so we're doing really good in terms of numbers. I'm really impressed with that. Because, again, people tend to think that Oklahoma is just a stupid hick state. We are not. Again, do we have hicks? Yes, but not very many of them, per se. But even so, I'm impressed with our state in that we were able to handle these situations really well. Because if you think about it, Oklahoma is not as populated as New Jersey or California, but yet we got the job done, and we got it done efficiently. And I'm not saying it was necessarily quickly, because I'll look at one of these. It says here, for example, one of the ones that was deleted was Compass Industries, Avery Drive. This one was located in the county of Tulsa. It was proposed for a Superfund site September 8, 1983. It was added to the list September 21st, 1984. And let's see, they started cleanup, I guess, June 30th, 1992, and they completed it or deleted it from the list July 18th, 2002. So I'm disappointed they didn't get it done a lot quicker, but in terms of all the other Superfund sites we have seen, Oklahoma actually has been doing a really good job of identifying Superfund sites, containing them per se, and then getting them cleaned up and get them deleted off the list. So if something is deleted off this list, then that means it's been handled, and more than likely the environment is back to what it should be, or at least near to the appropriate levels of safety. Excuse me, I guess is how that would be worded on that, because I would think that if they're being deleted from this list, then that tells me that it's safe, it's not a biohazard, so that's really good to see that. So go Oklahoma. We do a really good job on so many things, and yet it's so interesting how we get treated like the underdog. But you know what's great about being the underdog is that whenever we succeed at something, it looks really awesome. You know? Because I look at it this way. If people, as they say, be hating on you, as they say, then basically, you have a greater opportunity to prove a whole lot of people wrong. I mean, that's just kind of how it is with that. But anyway, let's take a look and see what the next state will be. Let's see. Oh, I was going to do Alaska or Arizona. So we'll do that on one of the next podcasts, because I think those states are really interesting, especially Alaska, which I think I mentioned last time. But I met some people this past weekend that I was telling them about my podcast I was doing, and of course the first question they have is, oh, are we near a Superfund site? And I was like, I don't know. I had not looked up Oklahoma yet. I was looking at other states. And so I thought, you know, maybe I should go ahead and do a episode on Oklahoma's Superfund sites and be a little more educated about that. So needless to say, when I read about Oklahoma, I was just so happy to see that we don't have like 500 of them, because, you know, because we do so much oil and gas here, that kind of concerned me that we would have a whole bunch of Superfund sites. But you know what's interesting about Oklahoma, and I don't know if very many people are aware of this, but we have really great schools here. We have really great universities, particularly UCO, which is the University of Central Oklahoma, OU, which is the University of Oklahoma. And then we have OSU, which OSU has a great veterinary school. They have a great engineering, I would say, department. And then they also have a really good architecture school there, and that's the Oklahoma State University. And I'm probably leaving out several other universities that I just can't think of off the top of my head, but those are kind of the big three here in the state of Oklahoma. But what's interesting is that people transfer to Oklahoma, to our schools here, from all over the United States and from other countries. So we have a really large amount of international students here, and also from other states. So what I find interesting about that is that our programs are some of the best in the nation, but you don't ever really hear about them because everybody just focuses on Yale, Harvard, and all these fancy schools. Nothing wrong with fancy schools, but they're not always the be-all, end-all. And I'll give an example. If you want to study about oil and gas, you need to go to a university where they specialize in that, at least in that state. So if you're wanting to study oil and gas, refinery, or engineering, or even if you're going to be doing like, if you're going to be a lawyer and you're going to be working in the oil and gas industry, you need to go to a university that's either in Oklahoma or Texas because we do a lot of oil and gas business here and we employ a lot of people, probably thousands of people, to do oil and gas when the federal government isn't punishing us for actually trying to supply the United States with local and national and natural fuel resources. But our departments here are great. Our universities are just amazing. So we kind of get the cream of the crop here, and I think that's really great. But here's the thing. Again, you're not going to know about that because pretty much all everybody ever talks about in terms of universities are these private schools or Ivy League schools. But, you know, you kind of need to go where the industry is. And the great thing about Oklahoma is, for example, if you want to major in oil and gas or do some kind of engineering in regards to that, the odds of you getting a job right out of college are really high. I would say 90 to 100% of you getting placed with a really good oil and gas firm because we know so many people here. And also, we know people in other countries that do oil and gas refinery and things like that because I've met people that have done internships. I think it was in Brazil or somewhere. I'm trying to think. But it's like all over the world. So, I mean, I look at it this way. We really should not be punishing oil and gas companies for trying to supply our country with a natural resource that we can use for people to get to and from work. And also, here's the thing. With these high gas prices, this also affects ambulances. Like, just think about that. It also affects our police departments. This affects everybody. So I think people really need to think about, you know, when you vote for a Democrat, especially someone that is pro-EPA, like to the extreme, or they're pro-globalization or pro-putting down the United States, or, you know, they're pro-high taxation, that affects everything. Like, I understand there's some people that think, oh, we should punish these companies and, you know, here's the thing. The law is already there to punish companies that make mistakes. Because if a company has a big spill, they should be punished. And they will be. I mean, I'm not saying excessively, but they do need to be held accountable for something that they do like that. You know, they need to clean it up, make things better, and do everything they can to repair the environment. What I don't like is when things go so extreme that it just doesn't make sense. Because when it goes so extreme, it doesn't just punish the company or the people that made the mistake. It punishes everybody. And that includes you and me. So that's what we're seeing at the gas pump. That's what we're seeing at the supermarkets when we see the cost of bread, milk, and meat, especially meat and milk. Those have been so high right now. Like, I mean, I don't have a problem with being able to afford that stuff, but it makes me not want to buy as much meat or as much milk. Like, I've been looking at other things to eat because I don't like having to spend almost $15 for bacon. That is insane. For pork, I mean, it's just unbelievable the cost of things. So I'm trying to make this point here that if things are going to be affected by inflation, you know, like, for example, whenever you have high cost of fuel, that means other things are going to go up in price because the way that we receive our goods is by transportation. In Oklahoma, we are very much a super busy state, especially in terms of semi-trucks, because we have, I think, anywhere from 2 to 4 major national highways that go through our state. Like semi-trucks from all over the United States are going through our state to get from the East Coast to the West Coast and from the North to the South. We are right there in the middle, and we're right in the breadbasket of the United States. But see, here's the thing. If you are for limiting gas and fuel in the United States, you are punishing yourself and your neighbor. You're not punishing the big CEOs. They're going to make their money one way or another, and they should because they own a company. But here's the thing. The more you punish them, the more you drive up the cost of goods because everything costs money to deliver those goods. And I'll give an example. I think I've mentioned this before, but back in 2011, my mother and I went on a religious pilgrimage to Italy to see all the different shrines and things like that. It was so beautiful, so wonderful. Absolutely loved it. But when we went there, the Italian people were super freaking pissed at their government. And so whenever we noticed they were having not a riot, but a strike, that's what it is. They were having a strike. I would ask the tour guide, can you ask them what they're striking about this time? Because Italians are known for being very mouthy, and not in a bad way, but they get really worked up about stuff. Well, they were really worked up, and I was like, what is going on in their country? Because I was like, should we even be here? Because there was something going on. Well, one of the strikes that the Italian people were super pissed off about was the cost of fuel. The cost of fuel, when we went over there, I did the math. It was almost $6 to maybe $9 a gallon if you do the equivalency in regards to gallons or however they measure stuff out there. And then also if you compare it to the euro, but it was about $6 to $9 in terms of US dollars per gallon. And this was back in 2011. And I was like, what in the world? I was like, who supplies their fuel? Like, who's charging them these ridiculous prices? Like, Italy's not too far away from the Middle East. Like, what's going on with this? Like, they're not having to fly it over a whole ocean, you know, like they do with us when we are not producing enough oil and fuel. Well, over in Italy, their government owns the gas stations. Their government owns all of the gas companies. So their crazy government, especially at that time, was being like a pro-environmentalist, like to the extreme. They were acting like an overinflated EPA system or EPA agency, and they raised the rates because they didn't want people to drive because they were quote-unquote concerned about the environment. But here's the thing. They punished the people. They punished them. And here's the thing. These people, they still needed to get to their jobs. They still needed to run their businesses. And here's the thing, it greatly increased the cost of goods while we were there. Like even bottled water was very expensive, not just for tourists, but for everybody. Because guess what? It costs money to transport all those goods. And mind you, they don't have semi-trucks in Italy, not like we have here. They have these really small European looking vans or something. I noticed them, like they were real dinky looking, but they're still shipping stuff. And plus their roads are not as wide as here in the United States, especially in Oklahoma and Texas. But here's the thing. It doesn't matter the size of your vehicle. If the cost of fuel is $6 to $9 a gallon, that's US dollars, the conversion rate, you know, all of your goods are going to go up in terms of pricing. It doesn't matter whether it's water, meat, your linens, chips, pizza, you know, jewels, whatever the case may be, anything that you transport from one location to another is going to go up drastically in cost and in price because your government increased the price of fuel to punish the people for driving a car. Like the Italian people were so pissed. And here's another thing. It also drove up the cost of using a bus, like a tour bus. Like, I noticed this when we were, when we initially signed up for this trip, there was, in the fine print, it said that you might have to pay $950 more, which is quite a bit of money for a trip to add on already, due to fuel charges. And I'm like, what does that matter? Like, what's going on with the fuel over there? Well, we may have our fuel pricing here in the United States, but it's nothing compared to over in Europe. Europe is crazy with socialism and just over-manipulation. Like, no one should be manipulated, but they were really over-manipulating their people, and it was suffocating their economy. It was costing them their jobs, and plus, the Italian people, the majority of them are poor. there are not a bunch of super rich, wealthy Italians over there. Like, we have way more rich people here in the United States than any other country. So just imagine if you have a poorer country like Italy. I mean, they're not like Africa, not by any means, not like those countries over there. But Italy, it's not as stable in terms of their economy. It's not as stable as the United States. So when you already have a country that's not as stable, and then you kind of have a semi-tyrannical socialist government, you know, claiming to care about the environment, but yet it punishes you, the citizen and the consumer. And also, it punished the visitors. Like, we were there, and so we were having to pay more money, not as much as the Italians, because, you know, we were only there for maybe 2 weeks. But the Italian people, they had really had enough. Like, I wish I could have read Italian back then, because their newspapers were just flooded with stories about people being extremely pissed off about what the government was doing and just punishing the people for just living everyday life. And I'm just like, wow, so this is what socialism is about. Like, here's the thing. That's the lie of socialism. It claims to care about you, claims to love you, claims to believe in inclusivism, but guess what? It's about power. It's about power. It's about limiting your resources, driving up cost of goods, causing inflation, driving up the cost of interest rates, preventing you from being a consumer. And then also, that's another way that their government tries to control an entire industry, which would be their entire private sector. So, you know, what's interesting is that we did not learn a lot about their public sector, which would be the people that work for their government. But you know what? Their private sector citizens were not happy with their government, and I completely understand why. So just know that whatever we are experiencing here in the United States in terms of the high cost of fuel, this has already been going on in Europe for years. Because whenever you try and pull the environmental card, oh, the we care, hashtag we care BS line, guess what? You're going to feel it in your paycheck. You're going to feel it in your wallet. And it's not going to feel that great. Like, you're not going to be making more money. You're going to be making less money. Because typically what governments like that do that claim to care, they typically say, oh, we need to go after these companies. We need to go after this industry because they're contaminating the planet or the environment. Well, guess how they go after those people? They go after the citizens, which includes you and me, especially if we own a business. So there's an appropriate way to handle things in a inappropriate way. And we saw it firsthand how socialism is not the answer. Like, when we were over there, there were so many Italians out of work. And I just thought, how are they feeding themselves? How are they feeding their families? There were places that we went. It was a little scary because it was chaos. I mean, it wasn't as bad as other places, but I just felt so sorry for the Italian people because they're good, kind people. They're fun. They're charming. They make great goods. They have amazing food. I mean, they're just trying to live everyday life, right? Just like you and me. But their government, even back in 2011, was just being a big bully and not really being kind and considerate to its own people. That's the thing. But here, let me say this. You get what you pay for and you get what you vote for. Like, if you vote for a socialist, then you really have no place to complain. Like, if you didn't vote for the person, then by all means, you know, make your complaints known, but, you know, do it in a kind and legal and ethical manner, right? Because I don't want to hear a bunch of complaining, but, you know, do something good about it, right? Like, do something constructive with it. But the thing is that Italy, it keeps voting in bad leaders. So, and it's been like that in Europe for a good while now. I would say since the 70s or 80s, at least from what I've seen, whenever I take international history classes or something, it just seems like Europe complains a lot, but they don't actually do any good about their complaint. Like, they don't think about it, and they keep voting in bad people. And I'm like, you know, if you really want true freedom, you have to vote for someone that actually believes in freedom. Meaning, you don't vote in a socialist, You don't vote in a fascist, and you for sure never vote in a communist. Like, you need to vote in people that are conservative and that believe in freedom and that believe in a true democracy, not a puppet democracy. See, that's the thing. A lot of these socialists, they claim to believe in freedom. They claim to believe in democracy. But when it comes down to it, they really only believe in themselves. And they just want to appoint their goons into these different positions and roles so as to control and manipulate the local, state, and I would say their countries, I don't know how to word, their leaders and their legislation, like those roles, those political offices. I was going to say state, local, and federal, but it's not necessarily like the United States. But I think you understand what I'm saying, where if you, let me put it this way, whoever you put in charge is who you are allowing to change the course of your country. Like, do you want it to go towards freedom? Or do you want less freedom? Because let me put it this way. You know, there is this one lady that was talking to me this last weekend. I met some really cool people. And I was telling her about my podcast. And, you know, she's from another country. And she said, oh, well, we need more laws here that really have more teeth, that really go after these companies. I was like, we already have those laws. I was like, the EPA is just not going after people. But yet they have a $9 billion budget. And that's an annual budget. I was going to do a podcast on the EPA. I need to do that next probably. But, you know, the EPA, they have a $9 billion annual budget. That's $9 billion. They have a little over 14,000 employees. Now, if you think about it, that's not very many employees compared to how large their budget is. And it's $9 billion a year at this point. But yet, we still have 40,000 Superfund sites. And a little over 1,300 of them are still on the national priorities list. So why is it taking so long to get this stuff cleaned up? Well, there's misappropriation of funds. There's mismanagement. There's people getting hired that have no business working in that industry because I look at it this way, the proof is in the pudding. And it's like they're not really doing a good job. You know, we need to see the results. But there are so many problems within bureaucracies like this. But see, that's the thing. This lady, she was from a European country, and she just was thinking, oh, punish the companies, punish the companies. See, that's a very European way to look at things. It's like they want things to get better, but they want to punish their neighbor. That's a very socialist way of looking at things, because she doesn't understand our way of life here in the United States, even though she came here for work, because I don't think she would be making the same kind of money she does here as she would in her homeland or whatever. Because the country that she's from, I'm pretty sure they're still bankrupt as a country. But that's just a very European way of looking at things. It's, you know, we want these rich people to pay. But it's like, okay, when you think that way and you pass legislation in that manner, all you're doing is you're giving your leaders and the authorities who are in charge of your country, you're giving them permission to be a bully and to rip apart your industries, to degrade or devalue your currency, ruin your interest rates, cause inflation within your country, and then make all these excuses to raise taxes, overspend, and then snowball your economy into bankruptcy, which is basically what is happening all across the EU. Like, there's so many European countries that are lousy at balancing their budget, because guess what? If they actually had to sit down and balance their budget, they would realize they totally suck at their job. Because they're not fiscally responsible. Like, they're not results-driven. They're shaming and blaming-driven. So here's what socialists tend to do. They like to play on your emotions. So what this lady was trying to do is she's like, oh, those companies, they're so bad. I was like, yeah, but so is the government. Did you know that some of the worst Superfund sites in the United States, they were caused by the U.S. military and by NASA? And her mouth just dropped. And I was like, look, I'm pro-military, I'm pro-NASA, but you know what? They dirty stuff up, too. And if you think about it, when they screw up and they cause a Superfund site, not only are they getting federal tax dollars, like, to fund the U.S. military, but they're getting federal tax dollars to fund NASA. And then now they're passing the hockey puck to the EPA. Well, again, those are federal tax dollars, meaning that's monies that we are paying for. So whenever you're dealing with a Superfund site that was caused by the U.S. military or by NASA, and they pass it off to the EPA, guess what? The American taxpayer is on the hook three times for that. So they're triple dipping. And you see, here's the thing. This European chick, well, she's not a chick, she's an older lady, but her mouth just dropped. I was like, that's the problem with this. We already have laws in place. We already have rules, laws, and regulations. The thing is, we don't have good people in charge of it. They're overspending. The EPA does not need a $9 billion budget and then hardly do anything. They're overspending. What I would want to know is how much are these employees making per year? Like, what's their gross annual income? Where's that money going? Like, my mouth dropped when I read up on EPA, which, mind you, was started by a Republican president. President Richard Nixon actually created the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency. He founded it and started it in 1970. And that was a Republican that did that. So for those that say that Republicans don't care about the environment and we're all about the private sector, not the public sector, and we don't care about companies that do bad things in the environment, I got to call the BS card on you. And liar, liar, pants on fire, because a Republican president was the one that established the EPA department and agency. It was not a Democrat. It was a Republican. And then since then, there have been Republicans and bipartisanship in terms of passing different rules, laws, and regulations to help repair our environment. But I think it's gotten so off course. $9 billion worth off course. It should not cost $9 billion to run an agency that is not even cleaning up these sites. And then they use these excuses, oh, well, we did our research, which I find that BS anyway. They say, oh, we did our research, and some of these Superfund sites are going to take 500 years to clean up. Really? Get to work. Clean it up. See, here's the thing. The EPA, when it started, it was a great agency. From what I found, the research on it, I think it has great goals, has a great mission. Almost the entire United States was for the EPA being created. Because there was such a public outcry about some of the Superfund sites that were littered across the United States at that time. Because the public wasn't sure what to do with this stuff, right? I don't think anybody was really sure what to do. So that's when, you know, a Republican president created the EPA, and he pulled the best and the brightest from almost every industry that could help, you know, clean up these areas and solve these problems. But over the years, the EPA has been bogged down with bureaucracy and just BS. Like, there are even some scientists that have quit working at the EPA over the years because they will publish something. They will give the EPA their findings, and the EPA will, there are people within the agency of the EPA, these bureaucrats, these professional paper pushers, what they've been doing is they have been redacting and removing critical information from these researchers' papers and not allowing them to publish all of their work in regards to what has really been going on. So the EPA, it has kind of gone down a rat hole. Because the EPA, it's been run by some really bad people over the years. And they're for putting up red tape. And here's why. They don't want people to really know what's going on. But they want the power and they want the money. Because over the years, especially during President Obama's years, and I don't think this just happened during his term. I'm not saying that at all. I think it happened during other presidencies as well. But they just don't want us to know about. There has been a tremendous problem with people within the EPA that basically are professional paper pushers, professional administrators, which is also a BS job, and then a professional bureaucrats, also a BS job. They basically target citizens like you and me if they want our property or our land, and they claim that it should be condemned. So then they give themselves the authority via the federal law to confiscate private property. Now, if that's not fascist and communist, I don't know what. Because that's what Stalin did. That's what Hitler did. That's what the Red Army did. That's what the Nazis did. Like, should we really be taking a leaf out of their book in terms of how to treat people? No, we should not. We are better than that. So there have been so many property owners that have been fighting the EPA. But get this. Do you know of any property owners that can fight an agency that has access to $9 billion and that can actually take them to court and win? See, that's the thing. When you're fighting the federal government, you are fighting someone who has access to our currency. They basically view it as their personal slush fund to bully people. And here's the thing. These bureaucracies within these federal agencies, they know that they can win. And they know they probably will win. And they know that if they drag the lawsuit out long enough, it will deplete the citizen of their financial assets. And they can't afford to defend themselves anymore. Gee, how is that legal and ethical? See, that is a tyrannical government. That is a tyrannical agency. And see, here's the thing. The EPA was not founded in a tyrannical way. It was actually founded in a humanitarian, very kind and caring way. It was never meant to target people. It was never meant to bully businesses. And here's another reason that businesses are having a hard time cleaning up their Superfund sites. And again, this European woman, she did not understand this. But I think there's a lot that people don't know. So it's like if they don't know, then how can they actually form a logical opinion about something? So I completely understand because I know what it's like to be ignorant on things too. But here's the thing. One of the biggest reasons why we have so many Superfund sites in the United States is because companies cannot afford the punishment from the federal government. It's like the rules, laws, and regulations and the requirements are so extreme. It's like it's impossible to meet any requirements whatsoever to try and clean something up because it's like the EPA and the federal government is just continuously punishing someone instead of helping them get right side up. And here's another reason why we have so many Superfund sites. So let's say, for example, we have a company that goes belly up, it goes bankrupt because it can't afford to clean up its mess for whatever reason, whether they were right, wrong, or negligent, whatever the case may be. Here's the thing. If another company comes in and tries to help them, legally, which I don't agree with this, legally the federal government can hold this new company accountable for previous damages, but retroactively. So what that means is that if there is another entity or company that actually wants to help repair the land and help the environment, they're frightened to do so because they're scared the federal government is now going to come after them via the EPA, via the rules, laws, and regulations and bankrupt them. That's not right or fair, and that's not the American way. See, that's a perfect example of where the federal government gets in the way of people helping other people. That is one of the biggest issues. And this lady that I was talking to about this, she goes, really? That's why? I said, yes, that's one of the biggest reasons why a lot of these companies, it's like they don't know what to do except throw their hands up in the air and just give the property to the EPA. Just basically give the EPA permission to confiscate their land and their property because they can't afford to deal with the EPA and or the federal government. They can't afford it. They can't deal with the stress of it, and they don't know what to do. And then whenever a scientist from the EPA actually wants to speak up about something, the EPA does what it can to silence that scientist. So it doesn't really allow their researchers and scientists to actually help our environment go back to being good and being repaired. And being, I guess, more natural in terms of nature. See, that's the strong arm of the federal government, and that has been a problem for a long time. Even though the EPA, it has great foundings. It has great beginnings. Everything I've seen about it is wonderful. They really care about groundwater, surface water, well water, soil, clean air. I mean, they did so much in the beginning, and that I just kind of feel like we get these career politicians in there that don't really know how to work appropriately or effectively in the private sector. So then they go to the public sector and they just try and, how do I word this? It's like they go to the public sector, they get in some kind of bureaucratic job or position, and then they use their power and authority in the public sector to just suck dry the private sector of its assets, of its financial earnings. That is not the role of government. We are the government, you and me, the powers with the people, the citizens of the United States. And you know what? It's not my job to target anybody. It's not my job to think, oh, there's a nice pretty house. Those people are rich. I want what they have. Guess what? That's coveting someone else's goods. We're not supposed to do that. And that's technically a form of thievery. If that's all you're doing is looking at what other people have and thinking, I want that, how can I find a way to confiscate it? That is evil. That is corruption and that is greed. But that is what is happening in the EPA. It wasn't like that in the beginning. That was not its beginnings. Its beginnings were actually quite good and wonderful. And I mean, I can't find anything bad. And believe me, I look for stuff like that. But, you know, I just think it's ridiculous that the EPA, they now have a $9 billion annual budget. And here's the thing. Who's going to tell them no? See, because they have such a cop-out, because all they have to do is throw it at anybody's face. Oh, are you one of those Republicans or capitalists that doesn't care about the environment? See, you're the problem. You don't really care. If you take away our budget, you're the problem. That's why we have these problems with the environment. Shame on you. That's how they talk to people. The reason why the EPA has gotten so big and so powerful is shaming and blaming. And plus, they try and pull at people's heartstrings. Well, don't you care about clean water? Don't you care about children? Oh, you don't care about kids if they swim in a polluted river? What's wrong with you? Well, gee, genius, of course we care. But if you don't even know how to manage your budget, and you've got money going down a rat hole, then you obviously don't care about the kids either. And you don't care about the environment either. And you don't care to do what's right. Because you're not doing what's right on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, on a monthly basis, on a quarterly basis, or on a yearly basis. Whose fault is that? It's agency's fault. That's not the citizen's fault. We're the ones that are paying this personal slush fund for this tyrannical agency that shows no stoppings. Like, someone needs to pump the brake on the EPA and be like, where is all this money going? How many Superfund sites do you plan to clean up and close down? I want a list. And I want to know why you haven't cleaned up the others that if you said you're going to clean up. No excuses. Get it done. And also, I want to know, I want a list of all the scientists and researchers you have fired over the years. And I want to know why you fired them. Was it because they were speaking up about something? Was it because you wanted to silence them? Is that what this is? Because here's the thing. Let's say, for example, we have medical researchers, right? They're very well-educated doctors. Let's say they're studying cancer or HIV-AIDS, right? So let's say they're trying to publish something, whether cancer-related or HIV-AIDS-related. Well, would it be appropriate for the federal government to say, oh, we need you to redact quite a bit of your research because we don't want the public to know what you actually found? We don't want them to know that this drug does work or it doesn't work as well. So you either redact it or you're fired or we'll pull your license so you can't be a doctor anymore. And we'll shame you and blame you in the medical community so that way no one will ever want to hire you ever again. So you will lose your livelihood and you will not be able to provide for yourself, much less your family. So we'll basically screw your future over if you don't do what we want. Now, let's see. I hope that has never happened to a researcher that's a medical doctor. But if the federal government did that to a doctor, we would throw our arms up in the air and be like, who does that? Like, that's completely unethical. Well, if it's unethical to do that to medical researchers, then why is it being allowed and tolerated in the EPA? I would think redacting important and vital information about health and safety in regards to toxic hazardous waste that affects the general public, I would think that would be really important. And it would take precedence. So I would want to know from EPA, what is actually important to you? What are you doing with our money? You are spending $9 billion a year, but yet you have a little over 14,000 employees. That is an insane amount of money for so few people. And what I find interesting is that the EPA gets $9 billion a year, our money, our federal tax dollars that get taken out of our paychecks, right? But yet people will shame and blame Wall Street. They'll shame and blame companies like Amazon, Apple, Microsoft, I mean, all these big companies for making a lot of money, for making a profit. Well, if it's bad for a company in the private sector to make a lot of money and employ a lot of people, then why is it not tick for tack over in the EPA? Like, why is it not considered bad that they get $9 billion a year, but yet they only have 14,000, a little over 14,000 employees? Like, that is very suspicious and odd to me. And again, the EPA can be a great organization. Their foundings are wonderful. Their beginnings are great. I love it. Everything I read about was amazing. I love almost every single rule, law, and legislation that they passed. And it's very rare I come across something that I agree with at almost 150%, right? But when something's off track, that gets my attention very quickly. And here's the thing. When it comes down to the EPA works for us. It works for the American people. We don't work for them. They work for us. They are supposed to protect us, not shake us down for $9 billion a year and then not even clean stuff up. And one thing I read about the EPA is they're going after some kind of social justice or environmental racism. I was like, oh, really? Is one tree talking crap to another tree? I'm sorry. There is no racism in the environment like that. Like, and here's the thing. If you're going to try and claim that the EPA is responsible and should look into different types of racism, I'm sorry, you are so off track and so stupid. You are a waste of my time and brain space. And you're also wasting my federal tax dollars. Looking into racism is a form of social justice. The environment has nothing to do with social justice. If you want to deal with social justice, go back to school, get your freaking law degree. Excuse my language. Like, I'm so sick and tired of Democrats and really far leftists pulling the racism card in almost every single federal agency. Let me put it this way. Get over yourself. Get your thumb out of your mouth. Stop sucking on it. Grow up, shut up, and listen up, and get to work. This is insane. Like, if you really want to help the environment, clean up the environment. I got news for you. You have 40,000 opportunities littered all across the United States to help. And guess what? Those Superfund sites have nothing to do with being white, black, brown, purple, blue, yellow, if you have hepatitis. I don't care what color you are. These Superfund sites have nothing to do with racism. They have nothing to do with social injustice. They have nothing to do with citizenship. It has everything to do with health and safety. It has everything to do with groundwater, surface water, soil, arsenic, lead, mercury, chromium. I mean, all these different chemicals. Like, that's not racism. But I was reading about this. I was like, these morons. This is why the EPA is run so poorly. And it's been run poorly for a long time. Long time. The EPA, the people that are in there and have been in there for a while, they're just using it as a slush fund. That's all they're doing. And I'm just like, wow, they obviously don't value human life. if they are not valuing human life, if they are not actually correcting the problems that we have with our environment. The environment is soil, air, water, nature. That's environmental. Anything outside of that is not the responsibility of the EPA. It is not. And for someone to think that all that other crap is part of the EPA, this emotional, moody BS stuff, like hashtag social justice or something or whatever, I'm just like, really, like, waste of my brain space, waste of my tax dollars, waste of my time. It's like, you know what, if I have to be an adult, then they need to be an adult. Like, grow up. If you're over the age of 18, if you're 18 and older, suck it up. Stop throwing a pity party. Stop having these stupid agendas that just cause division and strife in our country. If you want to do some good, actually go out there and get to work. Go out there and clean up those Superfund sites. Decontaminate the soil. Decontaminate our water supply. Clean up the air. All this other stuff is just fluff. It's just excuses to raise our tax dollars, to increase our tax rates. It's excuses to cause problems. It's just excuses to raise their budget and to make more money. See, here's the thing. Whenever you have a federal agency that has a $9 billion budget, that tells me they're not doing their job. If it costs that much, they're not doing their job. And they're profiteering. We need some people in there that actually understand the value of a dollar. And more importantly, the value of human life. Because what I find interesting is that the higher their budget goes, the less work they get done. That's a big red flag right there. If you have a $9 billion annual budget, that means yearly budget, okay? If you have a $9 billion annual budget and you still have 40,000 Superfund sites out there, I think you're not doing a good job. And if you're not doing a good job when you're working for the EPA, that means you're not helping the American people. And also, you are endangering future generations of Americans. Like, you are endangering our children by not doing what you are claiming you're supposed to be doing. And also, what you've promised to do. Because what we need to understand is that when you work for a federal agency like the EPA, you're basically making a promise that you're going to help clean up the environment. And if you are a manager or if you are in charge of something like that, then that is your promise to the American people. And it seems to me they haven't kept their promise for decades. Because guess what? They're still not helping. They're still not doing their job. And they're not always very kind to the researchers and the scientists that are actually trying to help. That's not right. That is not right at all, at all. But look at it this way. You know, I can get huffy and puffy about stuff like this all day and it does no good, right? So let's look at the good. The good thing is that the EPA is a good agency. Is it perfect? No. It is so far from perfect. It's very sad. The good thing about this is the EPA can always go back to its beginnings. That's what I would do. Like, if I was in charge of the EPA, I would go back to our original mission statement. I would go back to our original goals. I would knock out the national priorities list. I would put it on a timeline. I would set up a schedule and say, okay, we need to get this one done by this time. Who do I need to hire to get this done? How many employees do I need to hire to do this? If I don't have enough employees, what companies, what private sector companies can help me get this done? What specialists do I need to hire or recruit or contract out? Who do I need to get this done? Find them. They're out there. It doesn't cost $9 billion to be successful at something. It definitely costs $9 billion to be a failure if you're not accomplishing anything or if you're not doing enough. But the good thing here is that obviously the EPA does have access to money, our money. So being that they have that much access, I would think that they would want to do as much as possible with boots on the ground, so to speak. And I don't mean military boots per se. I mean hire really good people and assign them to each individual site. I personally would look up all the different companies in the United States. I would start local first in the United States before I hire from some other country, because our qualifications are so different and way better than other countries. I've learned that over the years. Just because someone says they're certified in something from like Germany or Spain, that doesn't mean it's equivalent to the United States, and it probably is not even as good or as educated. No offense, but it's true. What I would do is I would assign a private sector company to each Superfund site. And if we don't have that many companies, I would assign them to a particular state. And another thing, I would get bids first. I would ask all these different companies, tell me how long and how much it would take to clean this up and to do it right. And I would get 3 bids. And not these BS bids. And what I mean by that is I can't stand it when our government, whether it's state or federal, they find these companies that's all they handle is government contracts, and they just suck us dry of our tax dollars, but then they purposely drag out the projects so that they have employment for years and years and years, and they drag out these government contracts and projects, and it's like they never get done. An example of this is the Department of Transportation here in Oklahoma and Texas. I can't stand it. I hate it when they tear up our roads. And they're crappy roads. Like, whenever they supposedly repair them, guess what? We've got potholes and cracks within like a year. Well, you know what? Shoddy work is just that. It's shoddy. It's crap. We should get a refund, but do we get a refund? No. We keep hiring the same crappy people, the same crappy companies that don't do a good job. Why? Because they're handpicked by the government, because they're supposedly, quote unquote, the best government contractors. I gotta call BS on that. I'm so sick and tired of driving down the road and we've got potholes the size of multiple cookie cakes out there. I'm like, it is so hard on our tires and the structural integrity of our vehicles. It causes flats. But does the Department of Transportation come out and change your tire? Does it come out and give you a spare? No, you're on your own unless you have AAA or something. We need people that actually understand what is going on within the industry and that are not professional government private contractors. We need some new blood in there. Because what I've noticed, and there have been Senate hearings about this, there have been Senate hearings about, how do I word this, there are lobbyists, I guess, that go from working as a lobbyist to actually working for these companies and then trying to get positions in the government. So basically they just try and land these contracts, whether they work for the government or whether they work in the private sector or for a lobbyist company. I'm like, gee, that's a conflict of interest. I'm not saying their work can't be good, but I don't think we should just keep using the same people just because we know them or that, you know, they should get the contract over somebody else. We need to really start having some new innovation here. We need some new blood here. Because all we're having is a revolving door of the same private government business consultants, I guess, or contractors that they keep landing all these really cushy, highly paid government contracts, and their work is crap. And it takes like decades to get anything done. It's horrible. Meanwhile, the American people are paying those private contracts and government contracts, and yet we're the ones, we are fitting the bill, and we are the ones who are suffering as a result of their shoddy, crappy work, and it's not being done or completed in a good, legal, ethical manner. And most of the time, it's subpar work. But because it's listed under a government contractor, they get away with it. They still get paid regardless of whether they do a good job or not. Well, I'm sorry, that doesn't fly here in Oklahoma. I've used this example before. Let's say, for example, we get a really bad hailstorm, and you need a roofer to come out and repair your roof. Well, guess what? If they did a shoddy job, you're not going to pay them all of it because they did crap work on your house. And not only that, if they have a license, they can have their license pulled or their permit pulled. FYI, that's why whenever you have someone work on your property, they need to be licensed and bonded. Because that protects you in terms of liability-wise. Because otherwise, if they pretend to get hurt on your property, you're liable, unfortunately. And they can easily sue you, which sucks. Of course, if I was a judge, I'd throw that crap out. Be like, try and swindle somebody else elsewhere. I wouldn't put up with that in my court, but I'm not a judge. But anyway, there's so much that needs to change in regards to how work is handled when it's being federally contracted out. Because obviously, there are not enough employees in EPA, and whatever employees they do have, they suck at what they do. $9 billion worth of crap is what that is. And that's unfortunate because it's actually a really good agency. It started out good. It's just now it's turned into a slush fund for these overpaid bureaucrats that don't really care about the American people. They just want to confiscate their property. Well, sorry, that's illegal and unethical. And I would fight it tooth and nail. I totally would. As long as it's legal and moral, you're good to go. Whatever fight you fight, always fight it legally and morally. Because otherwise, you've already lost. And that sucks. But just make sure, well, I put it this way. I always pray about stuff before I go in for the fight. I always pray about it. That's just how I do things. Because I look at it this way, if I'm having to fight for something, I need all the help I can get, and the Holy Spirit is there for you. Because you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and they have your back. Crooks don't have your back. They just want to shake you down and throw you on your back and discard you and trample all over you. But when you take something up in prayer, it really gets God's attention. So regardless of what you're fighting, I would totally take that up in prayer because your Heavenly Father very much cares about you. And here's this. I don't think God likes the fact that we have 40,000 Superfund sites in the United States. Because technically, God put us in charge of the planet. And we're supposed to be good stewards of our planet. And the fact that we have 40,000 Superfund sites tells me we're not being good stewards. And not only that, we are putting the wrong people in charge to clean that up. So I think the EPA basically needs to be dethroned. I do think we still need them as an agency, but I think they need to be stripped of their budget. I think they need to be held accountable. I think they need to be audited. They need to have two audits, internal and external, meaning they have an internal audit, which means they audit themselves, but then you hire an outside company to come in and do an external audit, meaning someone that doesn't have the government's back. They're going to be looking for anything and everything and be like, okay, where is this money going? Why is it costing this? Where's the receipts? Where's the accounts payable? Where's the receivables? That's what I would do if I was in charge of EPA. See, because there's the thing. When you're dealing with tax dollars, you have a responsibility to the American people. You know, it's not just my money. It's everybody's money. It's everybody's tax dollars that were taken from their paycheck. That's a pretty big responsibility. And right now, it's a $9 billion responsibility. And here again, whenever people hear about $9 billion and stuff not going right, who do they think of? Wall Street. They think of the banking industry. Are they perfect? No, but they're not the biggest swindlers here. The EPA is probably one of the biggest swindlers in terms of federal agencies. But again, they get away with it because they pull on people's heartstrings, they work on people's emotions and their feelings, and they shame and blame. Shaming and blaming has no place in the EPA. None. They just need to get to work. I think they have a good cause. I think they have good goals. They're just not doing their job. That's why they have a $9 billion budget, but yet they're not accomplishing much. It's like a spoiled, rotten little kid again in Toys R Us on aisle 7. So not only is he throwing a hissy fit in aisle 7, now he's gone over into aisle 8, aisle 9, aisle 10. He's throwing a hissy fit over and over again, but increasing his budget, how much he's going to squeal. And I just wonder, how long are parents going to give in to this child, also known as the EPA? How much squealing are we going to put up with? They need to be audited. This is ridiculous. Here's another thing. Our environment, our country cannot take this. Not just from a federal budget point of view, but from an environmental point of view. We need to get this stuff cleaned up immediately. Immediately. A lot of these Superfund sites have been sitting there since they were nominated to be on the list, and this has gone back to the 80s. And one of their favorite excuses is, oh, well, it's going to take a long time. Really? What are you doing about it? Have you reached out to any other researchers or scientists that maybe could help speed this process up? Because the whole goal is to clean it up so that people don't get exposed to toxic and hazardous waste. I mean, look at it this way. It's like cleaning out your refrigerator. Are you really going to let mold and mildewy food just sit in there for over a year? Maybe some people do. That's really gross. And if you do that, sorry, you're a hoarder and you need to work on that. But clean it up. Just get it done. At least start on it. Some of these Superfund sites, they're not even fenced in. Every single one of these Superfund sites needs to have a chain link fence around it, and it needs to have up a danger or warning sign, and it needs to have a public notice on it so that the public, if they're driving by, walking by, or whatever the case may be, they see that this is a hazardous waste site. Do not come here. But they're not even fencing this stuff off. One of the Superfund sites we just talked about, they've got kids playing in the creek. Well, is that really appropriate? No. I mean, how hard is it to put up a fence? All you have to do is go to Lowe's or Home Depot, buy a bunch of chain link fence, install it, put up a sign, then start your research, start your samples. Start decontaminating. Like, here's the thing. We already have rules and processes and standards and protocols on the books of how to handle this stuff. But if we don't even start it, then what good is it to have all these super educated people tell us what to do all the time, or these bureaucrats tell us what to do all the time, if they're not even doing what they say they're going to do? Like, basically, they're not even showing up to work. We need people on the ground. We need people to get this stuff done. And I think, in terms of the United States, I think the states should start talking to each other. Because I feel like we're not really united right now. I feel like we're the separated states instead of the United States. I think there should be a meeting or a conference, specifically of all the governors. I think they should get together. They should talk about their Superfund sites, exchange ideas, and say, hey, this really worked in our area. What worked in yours? What company did you use? What researcher did you use? What method did you use? How long did it take? What was the cost? Just talk about it. Get it out in the open. I'm not saying have CNN there or MSNBC or Fox News. I could care less what those people think. They just like to frighten and terrify people. It is the responsibility of the leaders of every state to first of all acknowledge any problems that are going on, but also if they have a question or if they need help, they should feel free to be able to reach out to any governor in the United States and say, hey, we've got this issue. Do you know of anyone that can help? and help quickly and efficiently and effectively. What would you suggest? There is no shame in asking a question, but I feel like right now in our country, it's like everybody's supposed to have the answer. Well, guess what? Nobody does. Nobody has all the answers. But somebody does have one answer to one question, whatever it may be. We need to have open communication with each other because we are responsible for our country. We are not responsible for the planet. We need to take care of things here at home first before we start helping out elsewhere. I think the number one thing that we can do is have our governors reach out to each other and just have open communication with them. And I'm not saying have it on C-SPAN. I would say do not have it on TV. That's another thing. There are so many conversations that need to happen privately. You know, without fear of being recorded or something. But there's just all this media intimidation that is ridiculous, and it interferes with the job. It interferes with getting things done. Because I'll put it this way, you know, I wouldn't like it if someone had me constantly under the spotlight, and it's like everything I say, everything that comes out of my mouth, everything I do is criticized, scrutinized, demonized. I mean, what a hellhole. Who would want that? Nobody. I mean, you talk about stress. It makes it very difficult to get anything done if you're constantly being critiqued all the time. And it's like if you ever ask a question, you're deemed an idiot when you're not. It's never stupid or incompetent to ask for help or to ask a question. If anything, that tells me someone cares and they're actually wise. Because they're acknowledging the fact that they don't know everything, but they want the solution. They acknowledge they've got an issue, and they're willing to open up, ask questions, because they want it handled correctly, effectively, and efficiently. That takes courage to do that. It takes so much courage to do that. Because, I mean, just think about all the shaming and blaming that's done online right now. I mean, it's cowardice. These people that treat other people like crap online. But yet, more than likely, they wouldn't do that if that person was standing right in front of them. I mean, it's cowardice. But also, bullying is bullying. Whether it's in person or online or secret, whatever the case may be, it has no place in our country. And it gets in the way of things getting done. Like, for example, I'm not a huge fan of the EPA right now. But I am still a fan of the EPA. I don't like the incompetence. I don't like the overspending. I don't like the misappropriation of funds. I don't like the fiscal irresponsibility. I don't like the mismanagement. I don't like all these stupid causes and all these stupid hashtag BS agenda type things. But here's the thing. I don't believe in shaming and blaming. I believe in saying it like it is. I believe in speaking up. But I look at it as an opportunity to get the EPA back on track. Because wouldn't it be great, look at it this way, wouldn't it be great if the EPA was able to get all these sites cleaned up? Then guess what? Then they would never need another $9 billion budget ever again. Because they would have cleaned up all this stuff. And what an accomplishment. Now look at it this way. If they were to clean up all 40,000 Superfund sites, that would be documented, and then they could share that research with other countries that also have toxic waste and hazardous materials. See, because here's the thing. The United States does have Superfund sites, but we are not the biggest culprits in terms of pollution, not by any means. The two biggest culprits that nobody wants to talk about is India and China. They are horrible to the planet. But hardly anyone ever calls them out on it because they're two very large countries and we do a lot of business with them. Well, just because we do business with someone, that doesn't mean that we can't call them out on their illegal, unlawful, and unethical practices. If anything, when you're doing business with someone, that's when you're supposed to call them out on it. Because if people hold us accountable, We need to hold them accountable. It's a two-way street. But what sucks right now is that because of the super powerful EPA and people being for socialism, it creates a one-way street. And when you have a one-way street, it makes it very difficult to get things done because you're not open or willing to hear the other side. We cannot afford as a country to be narrow-minded or stupid or incompetent. We can't afford that. Literally, financially, socially. I mean, we just can't. And see, here's the thing. United States, we're supposed to set the standard for the world, right? I think this would be a great opportunity for the EPA to clean up all these sites. And then we can share our ideas, our research, our development. We can share with the two top industrial culprits that pollute the planet at a very high scale and a very rapid rate, India and China. We can help them. Not pay for it, no. We are not giving them money. They need to clean up their own messes, but we can share with them what works and what doesn't work. We should not be giving them any money. No federal funds. That's our money. It belongs to the citizens, not to people we don't even know. They're not even citizens here. We're not fiscally responsible for other countries. We need to take care of our own first. Because if we're going to set the bar high, we need to meet those standards every day. Because I look at it this way. If we're setting the standard high, but we're not even meeting those standards, what's the point of saying we have standards? We're hypocrites if we do that. In the United States, it's not a hypocrite. The citizens are not hypocrites. Some of our government agencies are hypocrites, yes. But that can always change. When you get the right people in there, people that actually care and that understand business management and they understand the value of currency and that you can't just spend and spend and spend and not view the American people as a personal slush fund, that's when you get stuff done. Because I look at it this way. When someone is fiscally responsible, they show true leadership. Because whenever you put someone in charge of anything that is just frivolous, I mean, that's like giving your credit card to some drunk relative that's just a boozer and a schmoozer and just uses people for money. Are they hardly ever going to do what's right? No. Every once in a while, maybe. But because they love money more than people and they love money more than doing what's right, guess what? They're always going to overspend. That's what a fiscally irresponsible relative does. So whenever I meet someone or I hear about someone that is fiscally responsible, I'm like, they will be a good leader. And they are a good leader. Because they understand what it means to value, how do I word this? They value their responsibilities. Because I've noticed, like, when I've had managers in the past, when they are fiscally irresponsible, their life is usually a wreck. Usually their marriage suffers financially, and it usually ends a divorce. Because money is a pretty big deal. It is. It sucks being married to someone that's stupid when it comes to money, or credit cards, or gambling, or whatever the case may be. They're just morons. I don't mean to be harsh, but it is very difficult to fall in love or stay in love with someone that has a character flaw like that, because that's what it is. People don't like to call it that anymore because they claim it's shaming and blaming, but it's not. When someone lacks character, that's not shaming and blaming. That's staying a fact. Because if you're not even going to call someone out on the problem that they have or even make them aware of it, then how are they ever going to get better? How are they ever going to address the issue that they have? Which is the same thing within the EPA and these other federal agencies. If we don't hold people accountable to the responsibilities that they have been given and that they have chosen to take on, then we're kind of like the spouse that enables their significant other to just ruin their marriage and to make their kids miserable. Like, you know, how do I word this? We should not be enablers. We should not be enablers. And I'll give an example that's off topic. You know, like, we have a problem with obese children in this country, which is sad, but we do. Well, who's enabling them? Those kids don't have jobs. They're not making money. They're not able to go out and buy all the food. It's the parents. So you have parents that are enabling their children to overeat and eat the wrong foods. That's why we have all these fat kids. Because most children, I would say, are minors, you know, under the age of 18. Most of them do not have jobs. Hardly any of them know how to cook. So where are they getting the food? And where are they getting the quantity of food? Guess what? They're getting it from their parents, who may or may not also be overweight or obese. It's the same thing when we're dealing with federal agencies and the American people. The American people, we are enabling situations like this that are not good. Excuse me. But the good thing, excuse me, drinking some water, we can always turn over a new leaf and make it better. And the way we do that is, first of all, at the voting booth. We vote in people that are fiscally responsible, that understand supply and demand, that understand we do need audits, we need internal and external audits, and that will, how do I word this, not view the American people as their personal piggy bank, and they will honor and respect their budget, and they will hire the right people and fire the wrong people. We need people that actually care to do the work. I mean, because who doesn't love to go to the mall and just spend a bunch of money? But see, here's the thing. That's what children do. That's what teenagers do. They're not fiscally responsible, and they're not mature in their thinking and their process, you know, their processes of thinking. We need someone that, you know, even though pretty much everybody in the plant loves to spend money, but if you overindulge in something, then you're going to cause a bigger problem. So we need people that understand the value of common sense and that understands fiscal responsibility and is not just going to give in to the whim of a bureaucrat, but actually says, hey, I need to see why we need $9 billion. I need to see where it's going. If it's legit, hey, not a problem, but we need to figure out, why is there so much money going towards this? And how can we make it more fiscally feasible? See, because I look at it this way. Amazon is a wonderfully successful company because they have supply and demand, but they are fiscally responsible. They understand where they need to spend money and where they don't need to spend money. Because wherever you don't need to spend money is typically the stuff that you can cut off. You can basically cut off the fat. Or if it's a department where you do need to spend money there, but it's not currently being spent in a fiscally responsible way, regroup, analyze what's going on, and make it better. Make it more fiscally responsible so that it's not wasting money, but it's actually helping to produce profits. It's actually helping to produce or increase your profit margins. That's being fiscally responsible. See, the federal government, if it actually wants to have a whole bunch of money to spend, the smartest thing to do would be to take a leaf out of the book of any and all these major companies that do really well, and see how they handle their company, and then implement those policies and procedures and those ways of doing things within their government agencies as they see fit and as are applicable. Make some tweaks and changes here and there. But unfortunately, sometimes we get people in these positions, whether it's management or employees or underlings, whatever the case may be. Nothing against underlings, because I'm all for the underdog, but we need people to understand the value of a dollar. Because the more we have people in charge that overspend, the more they weaken the dollar. And that's where you have inflation. So if you have one government agency that is weakening the dollar, guess what? It's probably happening in multiple agencies, which I can think of the VA, the EPA, oh gosh, anything to do with Medicare or Medicaid. Totally draining our system, totally draining our money. It's just not run really well. Can it be run well? Yes, by all means. There's always room for improvement. And that's one of the great things about America, is that even if something's not going the best, we can always make it better. But one of the biggest mistakes we can make is to not acknowledge we've got an issue, or get sidetracked, or just continue to overspend. An example of that is Jimmy Carter's presidency, and also President Obama, and a little bit of Bill Clinton. I can't think of a single reason why we should have inflation like what we have now. I mean, it's really unacceptable, because we are the United States. And see, here's the thing. When we have inflation like this, it also affects government agencies. So whenever we have inflation that is like this, what's going on right now, basically the federal government cannot collect as many taxes. So it's actually shooting itself in the foot by mismanaging money, because then if your people are not making as much money, or if they can't afford to buy as much as they usually do in terms of goods and quantities and needs, guess what? Not as much tax dollars are going to be collected. So then you've got an overspending federal government who can't even pay its bills. And typically what ends up happening is then the federal government says, oh, we need more money. So then they raise taxes even more on the people, on the citizens, that can't even really afford to pay all these funky taxes, especially in the state of California and New York. So that creates continuous inflation. But it gets worse when it's at a higher and more rapid rate. So inflation actually makes it more difficult for the federal government and the state government to do its job for its citizens, especially with their social welfare programs or their federal agencies. See, that's the stupidity sometimes of the federal government. They overspend, raise taxes, and they wonder why they don't have as much money coming in. It's because people don't have as much money to spend. They're basically feeling the squeeze on their pocketbook and their checkbook at the pump and at the grocery store. Those are the two biggest things. Oh, and their rent and their utilities. The basics. If people cannot properly afford the basics, you've got a bigger problem than you realize on that. We really need to cut our spending. We need to cut our spending. We need to lower taxes. We need to give the private sector a chance to recover and to recuperate. Not just from COVID and Omicron and all these stupid variants. I could care less. That's what viruses do. They mutate. It's no different than the flu. The flu virus, guess what? Every time you get a flu vaccine, it's a slightly different strand of the flu virus, influenza. Why? Because it mutates. Why? To stay alive. It's the same thing with the coronavirus. That's what it's going to do. But needless to say, we need to get back to normal. Not just from COVID stuff, but our economy needs to get back to normal. We need to have a booming country again. We need to have prosperity again. We need to have wealth again. We need a larger middle class. And the way that we get a larger middle class is to give people a chance across all gaps, all income brackets, to make way more money without all these high taxations, right? So what that means is the way the middle class grows is if you have more poor people in the lower class moving up into the middle class. That's how you have a wealthier country and a more proactive economy and a more prosperous country. And also what happens, the middle class, some of them move up to the upper class to becoming wealthy. So you have less people being poor, more people moving up into the middle class income bracket, and then you have more people moving up into the wealthy income bracket. That's how you get more revenue in federal taxes to be able to pay for all these things that the federal agencies want to do and need to do. The EPA wants to do these things. They want to clean it up. It's not effective. They want to do it, but they also need to do it. We do need the EPA. But guess what? I don't think they need a $9 billion budget. And if they do need that kind of budget, we need a super prosperous country. I remember when gas was under a dollar, back when I was a teenager. I remember being able to fill up an entire tank of gas for like less than $20. I could go in with a 20. I had a part-time job as a teenager most of the time. I could fill up my vehicle and be good for like a couple weeks. Now, oh man, I'm paying anywhere from $80 to $200 to $250 a week in gas. A week. And guess what? Because of high gas prices, I don't drive as much as I used to. Like if I can not have to run an errand or go do something, I skip it. And guess what? Because I'm skipping out on that stuff, I'm not spending as much money at stores. That's just what the American people are having to do right now with what's going on with this inflation. But getting back to EPA and Superfund sites, the EPA is important. It is vital. It's off track. And it obviously needs our help, and it obviously needs funds, but also needs a good audit. So being that it does need help, I think it needs to be restructured. I really do. I think it needs to be restructured, and I think that we need the private sector to completely recover so that way the federal government can collect more taxes, not at a higher tax rate. I would say at a lower tax rate. I think the federal government should lower taxes across the board to no more than 10%. That way everybody has more money in their pockets. Not just the poor and the middle class, but everybody across the board. Because it's not right for one group of people to get stuck with more of a tab than somebody else. That's not right. That's punishing someone for being more successful. So we need to lower taxes down to 10%, just a flat tax across the board. We need to do an internal and external audit of EPA. We need to recruit companies that specifically handle or focus in terms of industry of environmental hazardous waste and how to clean it up. We need to get a minimum of 3 bids per Superfund site. I think each state should hire its own company, if not 2 or 3 companies, to handle their sites, see how they do. Maybe have one company handle this site on this side of the state, have another company from the private sector handle another site on the opposite side of the state. Let's see how they do. Let's see how they work out. And it not be companies that are government contractors that have been used all the time. We need some new blood in there. Big time. Big time. Because I'm just like anybody else. I don't like my money being wasted. I don't like it being used on people that don't do a good job and they don't even care to do it well because they know they're going to get a paycheck regardless of where they suck at what they do. That's thievery. That's stealing. When you know your work sucks, but yet you're still trying to get that full paycheck, uh-uh. Not when it comes to government bids and contracts, no. No. Especially not when it comes to labor like that. By all means, no. Otherwise, we're going to lose accountability. And we need that accountability to be there, to get things done effectively, efficiently, and fiscally responsibly. Otherwise, we're just pouring our money down a rat hole, and I think we've done that long enough. But to end this podcast on a positive note, because I know there's a lot of stuff we discuss in this podcast, there's always room for improvement. There's always room for positive things, and there's always room for doing the right thing. And I think it would be such an accomplishment for our country to clean up every single Superfund site in the United States, all 40,000 of them, because I do believe it is possible. Because people care. People want to do what's right. There are so many people that want to do what's right, but they're having to deal with all this red tape and with bureaucracy. Well, get rid of the red tape, give people a chance to do their job, do it well, and give people a chance to care. There are so many people that want to help our country. There are so many Americans that they want nothing more than for the United States to be a good, clean country where they don't have to worry about toxic fumes or the air or the water supply or the soil. And they're willing to help, regardless of whether they work in the private sector or the public sector. I would say all across the board, I would say the entire United States, every citizen here, cares about the future of this country. And they want good things for our country. I just think sometimes people get frustrated and they don't know how to take that first step towards having a positive future. And that first step is to have it in your mind, I am going to have a positive future. What can I do to help? Because the battle starts in the mind. We may think it's the stuff that's in the field or the tanker trucks or contamination. That's not the first hurdle. The first hurdle is how we view and how we think about things. Like I said before, I can huff and puff and be pissed off all day, which I don't care to do that. I would rather get stuff done. Get it done appropriately and just have it be good. And do all these things in a good and kind manner. Because when you care about doing the right thing, you're less likely to make a mistake. And if you do make a mistake, it's probably not going to be as bad as someone that doesn't care at all. But also, you will catch your mistakes a lot sooner, a lot quicker, so you can fix them and correct them going forward. And the odds of you making that mistake a second or third time are actually quite low because you're willing to acknowledge, hey, that process didn't work, let's change it. Let's do something different, something that does work. What do we need to do? Let's work on it. We have the ability to do what's right. We have the ability. We have the character. We have the love of our country to do this, to get it done. We need to put the agendas aside. We need to put the hashtag causes to the side. I think we need to get rid of those altogether. I think it's stupid, all the crap that happens on social media. It obviously hasn't helped our country doing all that stuff. It hasn't made us proactive. It's turned a lot of people into a bunch of aggressive, bitter Betty whiners that wouldn't know how to clean a crock pot if they were paid to do it. I mean, it's just like, you have to get up and do something good if you want something good to happen. You have to be proactive. Like whatever your talent or skill set is, that's where God has you and that's where he wants you to be. And he wants you to grow in that position, and he wants you to be successful at what you do, regardless of what occurs. Because I know that even though there can be tough things that we face, if we have the right goals, if we have the right intentions, then that is the first step in going in the right direction. Because when people actually care and they actually put action behind that caring, that's where the rubber meets the road. It's not in the law courts. It's not in bureaucracies where stuff gets done. It's with everyday people. And especially if they're given the chance to do the right thing because they love their country. And I'll give an example. I'll close with this. If you want to have a general idea of how much people care about their country, go to a baseball game. See how many people attend and how many stand for the, I was going to say Pledge of Allegiance. That's not it. Our national anthem. I wish we did the Pledge of Allegiance. I think our country was a lot better, a lot safer, and a lot kinder to each other and to other people when we did the Pledge of Allegiance, especially in our schools. But whenever people stand for the national anthem and they put their hand over their heart, you better believe they care, and they care about something greater than themselves. That's one of my favorite parts about going to a baseball game, is when we sing as a country our national anthem. That always warms my heart, because like I can have a total crap day, go to a baseball game, and we sing that national anthem, and it's like I hardly know anybody that goes to these baseball games. You know, I don't know everybody, but I know the people that are next to me, people that I go with. But what's interesting, what's interesting is when you stand together as a people and you're there for the common good, and I don't mean that in a socialist way, not by any means, but you're there for your fellow man, and you're standing in unity with each other, there's something about that that is pure, that's good, that's holy, and has good intentions across the board. That's how much the American people care about their country. And that includes you, that includes me. So even though there may be things that are frustrating in our country, there may be crazy things going on in our world right now, which there are some crazy things going on right now, which would be Russia and Ukraine. But regardless of what's happening, we need to really focus on what's important for the United States. And we need to come together as a country. Because if we don't come together in unity as a country, we can't really help anybody else. Otherwise, it's just too many chiefs, not enough Indians. I mean, I don't always like cliches, but it kind of speaks true. So I'll close with this. If ever you are feeling down or you're uncertain about things in the United States, go to YouTube and look up, you know, like just a random baseball game and look up national anthem and just watch how many people stand up and sing the national anthem and they put their hand over their heart. And if there are guys there wearing baseball caps, I love this. They take their baseball caps off and they place it over their heart. That's being a gentleman. We have good men in this country. We have good women in this country. We have good kids in this country. We need to focus on the good, not the bad. Because it's when we focus on the good that we can correct the bad and get things done. That's where we can do the most good. It's kind of like that phrase, count your blessings, count them twice. That's one of the great things about being an American, is that even though I may not agree with hardly anything that the extreme left does, but I know that when we stand side by side, especially you know, with the national anthem or with the military or things like that. I know that I don't really care about our differences because we're standing together. We're standing together in unity, which makes us the United States, not the separated states. We are the United States of America. Until next time, I pray that you're happy, healthy, and whole, that you have a wonderful day and a wonderful week. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.